So in the last video, we looked at randomness and chance music, trying to make things kind of sound as random as possible. In this video, we're going to keep on working with random numbers, but we're going to step back from that for a little while to look at a technique called stochastic composition, which is really about how to carefully structure our random decisions so that we have more control over the shape of the music. In particular, we're going to look at probability distributions and Gaussian distributions in particular. Take the example that we used in the last video and try to make it sound a little bit more intentional and less random. We're also going to look at the music of one of the pioneers of this technique of stochastic composition, Yannis Xenakis. So let's talk about stochastic composition versus chance. It kind of comes down to a couple of key questions here. One is, how many random decisions are we making? Because if we're making a lot of random decisions, not just five or 10, but hundreds or even thousands of random decisions, then we have the ability to really shape the probability distribution of those random numbers in a meaningful way. So that they're not just coming out so with an even chance of any number coming up, but if we stack the odds, basically, if we make some outcomes more likely than others, if we do that enough, then we're going to actually be able to hear that and hear that the effect of that in the music. So if we make enough random decisions, we have this ability to use stochastic techniques to control the distribution of those random decisions and the results of them and shape the music that way. The other thing that we can think about is, how are those decisions structured? In other words, are we just kind of blindly taking the random numbers that come out and then using those to kind of feed into function arguments or some effects value or something like that? Or are we thinking really carefully about the mapping that's behind these? How are we taking this and bringing it in a musically sensible way that supports what we're trying to do in the music? So I'm going to walk through both of these as we refine the example that we built in the last video to make it more an example of stochastic composition and less an example of chance composition. So the first thing I want to talk about are probability distributions. So far, we've been using things like the random function from Python, and we've had uniform distributions where every outcome is just as likely to arise as any other outcome. So with random, you're just as likely to get any number between 0 and 1 as any other number. They're all equally likely. Same way as if you flip a coin, you're just as likely to get heads or tails. So you might get 3 heads in a row or even 10 tails in a row if you feel really lucky. But if you do thousands and thousands of coin flips, eventually you're going to converge on a uniform distribution where you've gotten just about the same number of heads and tails. Same thing is true with random. What we're going to look at now is a different kind of probability distribution, a Gaussian distribution. And you've all probably seen something like this bell curve-like thing before, where you have a central value, which is kind of the one that's maximally likely to come back, and then some kind of slope out from there. And so as you get towards the edges, things become decreasingly likely. So you're very unlikely to get these values. You're very unlikely to get those values. You're very likely to get that, and then you're pretty likely to get those, and so on and so forth. So we can use the Gauss function in Python to create one of these Gaussian distributions so that we can control the likelihood of different outcomes coming through. And we specify it in terms of two different arguments. One is the mean, which is this central number here. And the second one is a standard deviation, which controls the slope of this, essentially. So the higher the number, kind of the flatter that becomes, and the more is under the bell of that curve. So let's go ahead and go back to the example that we were working with in the last video, my kind of maximally random example. And I'm going to make just one simple change here, which is that I want to change how I'm selecting the starting points of each of my randomly chosen sounds. So instead of random times 8, I'm going to do Gauss with a mean of 8 and a standard deviation of 3. So the peak of my likelihood is going to be at measure 8. So this is actually going to be spread out across more than 8 measures. So since we're spreading out across more measures, I'm going to go ahead and increase the number of random sounds that I'm spreading around as well. That'll also make it more likely that this distribution will start to emerge. I'll go ahead and do this over a few more tracks too. So the likelihood of the overlap is a little bit lower as well. I'll go ahead and run the script. So really, all I did was change that random mapping from a uniform distribution to a Gaussian distribution. And so I want to look at this second question. We've covered the distribution part of this. And this is kind of a macro level attempt to create a sense of a large scale form to it. Because this kind of diagram also corresponds to something we see in music a lot, an arch form, where you kind of build up tension or density towards the middle or some climactic point of the piece, and then you decrease it again towards the end. So we've done something along those lines by creating this Gaussian distribution in terms of the density of our sounds, how many sounds are happening at any given time. But we've left something out, and that's that we've kind of ignored the meter of the music here. A DAW is very good in giving us a timing grid, and all these sound files were created with a tempo and a meter in mind. And we've kind of ignored that because we're randomizing the starting point to a floating point number, so it can start from any point in the middle of a measure. So what I want to do is try to bring back some of that sense of beats and meter and tempo in this music. And I want to bring in some math functions to do that. So here are some common functions in the math library in Python. So this is a whole other API where if we want to use it, we can start off our Python script with this line from math import star. And then we get all these things like sines and cosines and tangents and things like that. I want to in particular just use one simple function right now, floor of x. That basically returns an integer that's the highest integer that's still less than whatever x is. So if x is 1.25, the floor of it is going to be 1. If x is 3.14159, the floor is going to be 3, and so on and so forth. So using this, I can go back to our script, and I can look at our start time here. Which is a floating point number generated by that Gauss function. And I can, first I can come in here and I can import our math function. So from math import star. And then here I can simply say floor of Gauss 8,3. So now I know that my sounds are always going to start at the beginning of a measure. They're never going to start at some random place in the middle. They're always going to start at the beginning. So we're going to reinforce that sense of meter. And then if we look at our ending time, I can do something else here, because the durations of these are also totally random, and they don't line up with beats at all. So I can do something here, rand int, say, 2,4 times 0.25. So what this is doing is it's saying, well, I'm going to pick a random number between 2 and 4. So if it's 2, it's either going to be 2 or 3 or 4. Those are my three options. So then I'm multiplying it by 0.25. So 2 times 0.25 is 0.5, which corresponds to 2 beats. 3 times 0.25 is 0.75, which corresponds to 3 beats. And 4 times 0.25 is 1, which corresponds to a full measure. So every time the duration, it's always going to start at the beginning of a measure, and then it's going to last either 0.5, 0.75, or 1. So in other words, 2 or 3 or 4 beats long. So with those two simple changes, I've essentially quantized. If you remember back to Module 3 when we were doing quantization and MIDI sequencing, I'm doing something similar here. I'm kind of quantizing my random numbers so that I'm always starting at the beginning of a measure, and I always have an exact duration that's either 2, 3, or 4 beats. So you can go ahead and run that script. I want to talk about an important historical example of stochastic composition. This is a Greek composer named Yannis Xenakis. He actually helped develop a software program called ST, which stood for Stochastic Music. And he wrote a number of pieces with this. This piece is called ST/10, which meant that it was written for 10 musicians. And he wrote this in 1962. The way this worked was his computer program actually didn't generate sound. It just generated note data. Things like start time, what instrument in that ensemble of 10 musicians is playing the note, what its pitch is, what its duration is, what its dynamic is. And he loved glissandi, so there were actually a few different parameters that controlled whether there was a glissando, and if so, whether it was up or down, and how far it was going, and things like that. And once he got that note data out of the computer, he transcribed it, not so different from what Hiller and Isaacson did with the Iliac suite that we looked at in the first video in this module. He transcribed this note data onto a musical score that musicians could then rehearse and perform on traditional instruments. And there were stochastic decisions being made throughout to control things like the parameters of this note data that we just discussed above, the density of notes in a particular section, how long a section is of the music, and so on and so forth. And he used a variety of different distributions, including normal and Gaussian distributions like the ones we looked at here. Now I want to make one final point here, which is that stochastic music is not limited to avant-garde or experimental musical practices. I was playing, just yesterday, I was playing on my iPad GarageBand with my son, and he opened up this smart drum instrument on it, where you actually drag pictures of drums onto a grid, and the y-axis of where you place them controls their dynamic. The x-axis says complex on one side and simple on the other. And so you're controlling this kind of stochastic aspect of how each drum within the selection of different drum samples is playing, how dense it's being triggered. And then, as if that's not enough, there's a little picture of a dice at the bottom of the screen. If you hit the dice, it will randomly place different instruments in different places on this grid to create a new drum pattern for you. So the kind of consumer purpose of it in a program like that seems to be that everyone wants their own kind of unique drum pattern, but they don't necessarily want to program it from scratch the way we might in a pattern sequencer. So this kind of stochastic approach gives people the ability to generate over and over and over again until they find something that they like, or to tweak the parameters of each of these things until they find something that they like. So to review what we've done in this video, we've talked about the differences between chance and stochastic music in terms of distributions and mappings. We've looked at probability distributions, such as Gaussian distributions, as a way to structure chance decisions into a more stochastic approach. And we also looked at math functions, like the floor function, to help us quantize and kind of use the metrical grid to perform different kinds of mappings with our random numbers. And then finally, we looked at the music of Yannis Xenakis as an example of using stochastic techniques in composition. In the next video, we're going to look at a very different approach to algorithmic composition in the form of process music.